First of all, raise your arms like this. We are all together, okay? Right. Now, I want to make a couple of things very clear. First of all, many thanks to the Students Union, to all of you, to invite me over to sort of share some of my thinking with you. First of all, I want to make a couple of things very clear. One is that I wish to go on record whatever I'm saying. So there should not be any hiding, anything like that, okay? Everything has to be on record. Second thing is that I speak as of now, right now, I speak as I was invited as an individual faculty member. I'm also, as you know, the president of the SCST Employees Welfare Association. So there was very little time to consult with them. So as of now, I'm speaking as an individual faculty member. As an association, we have already extended support to you in a formal capacity. Okay? So we have written to the acting director about this. All right? Right. So now, usually what happens is that, this is a common predicament in TISs, that a lot of teachers, they sort of teach activism in class and they teach theory within activists, you know. So I don't want to get into that trap and discuss things like that and make the same mistake. So I will, if you give me sort of half an hour of your valuable time, I'll say a couple of things that I have to share with you. All of you, I have been noticing for quite some time, although I was hardly directly involved, because I interact a lot with students. So I have heard that you have been having this issue regarding the scholarships for a long time, which includes the scholarships also for the OBC students, as well as the scholarship also for non-NET students. Okay, this, I mean, the type of grant which they used to give. So I'm given to understand that gradually all of them have been shut down, and or they're going to be shut down very soon, and the institute has taken this decision. This also comes, this type of a thing also comes against the context of many other student-related matters which have been taking place for the last few years, one after the other. Say, for example, starting with the hostel issues about cooking, and then about eating food, and things like that, about your use of the library timings. There were so many issues which I get to hear from students, which come as a sort of a package along with this. So I'm very happy, and I wish to sort of congratulate you that you have been able to do one thing which has never happened in TISS before. I've been here for 2 decades, and I've heard a lot about the past, which is basically to have a very sharp, well-formed critique and a protest about what are the issues and what you all are asking. From what I gather, it has been very clear in your minds. And second thing is that it has also been the case that all of you are here together. Now, all of us know that, as is usually the case in most universities, students are usually have different type of affiliations. In TISS has a remarkable institution, very strange I found after I came from JNU and West Bengal, that here they do not ostensibly, the students don't have any political affiliation, but nonetheless, you all each have a very different type of an affiliation. But what is remarkable about this gathering is that for the last few days I'm seeing, is that all of you have basically come together. So my first, and many congratulations for that. Okay, so you all have cut across caste, class, race, region, language, everything, your own specific personal affiliations. You know, you might still want to believe in a particular ideology or things like that, but all of you have come together, that's very great. If some of you all are having certain differences of opinion, my request as a preliminary remark would be is to all of you get together, sit down, and then thrash it out, because I don't really see here anybody, any student, any group here who has been trying to usurp the space for their benefit. That has not happened, I'm quite sure about that. So that's very good on your behalf, and it would be very nice if you can sort of convince some of you all who are not convinced to come together. But it's very good what you have done. Now, what is the reason why I feel that what you all have done is very significant? And that's the point that I want to point out in the context of this institution. Now, the first thing that you get to, I'll leave it open for a few questions and answers, say, after some time, so do ask me them. But if I'm not mistaken, the first thing that you all are sort of indoctrinated once you come in, and perhaps also some of the presumptions that you make before you come in here, is that you come in because this is an institution which stands specifically for social justice and human rights, right? Now, we all know that the nature of modern education is supposed to stand for human rights and social justice. Universities are supposed to be the fountainhead of enlightenment and, you know, justice and rights and so on. But one good thing about this institution, at least as far as its claim is concerned, is that it has always tried to sort of operationalize this idea or this concept. And hence, therefore, your fieldwork and, you know, your engagement with projects and, you know, with different type of interfaces with different people's organization, you know, all this is a part of the legitimate enterprise of this curriculum and the syllabus that you are here for. That's good. So my point is that we should begin precisely from this good point, you know, and therefore, you know, locate our, you know, your protest against that. Now, so the first thing that appears to be very clear to me is the fact that you all are asking for you know, resolution of the problem of the scholarships. Against this, you all have other demands which are fairly legitimate, starting from living conditions to you know, the curriculum, the type of teaching that goes on, etc., etc. Now, when you have raised this issue, it goes directly to the heart, I think, of the vision and the mission of this institute. So the first point that you have succeeded in doing, I think, from what I observe from a distance, is to be able to sort of very clearly present on the table to everybody in this world about the very hypocrisy of this institution in what it basically does. Now, all of us, those who are from a different, you know, political or non-political bodies who are connected to this institute, at different levels we fight on this issue of what is stated as the philosophical goal and what is actually done and practiced, right? Now, this gap between theory and practice is a very old conundrum. I don't want to get into all this very high-flowing discussion and all that, but the main point, I think, which you have risen that and which you can consolidate and raise consistently, is the fact that the vision and the mission of this institute very clearly articulates that the very justification, the very foundation of this institute is to basically ensure that all of us become vehicles of social justice and human rights in what is ostensibly accepted as an unjust, unfair and an unequal society, cutting across all parameters. So it is in this context of inequality and unfairness that we are being trained here in order to see if we can do something for the world around us, right? Now, if that is the case, if that is supposed to be our justification, our training, our future career, our lives, then I assume that the first place where this sort of thing should be implemented and practiced is with you, with us, inside the boundaries of the institute. So it's here that you first, as everybody says, that justice begins at home. So it is here, first and foremost, that every principle that you all are trained in, you all are spoken to, that you all actually practice outside and what the faculty and the administration teach you, these principles must be first of all implemented here. Now, I think that one of the points that you all have been able to do through your articulation of this protest, it's a record in this institute, is to basically bring this to the fore, all right? Now, give me the privilege of being able to elaborate this with a few sort of bureaucratic details, if this helps you to sharpen your argument. Now, we have been listening consistently, perhaps you too, you have been listening consistently, that there has been, you know, two arguments which have been usually forwarded broadly in order to justify this cut or whatever decisions are being taken. One is that the UGC is reducing its grants, or the Government of India, which is responsible for providing the necessary grants to the necessary constituencies, have been reducing its grants, and therefore the institute is not in a position to help you further. That's one point. The second point that has been mentioned is that there has been a huge expansion of this institute, and many programs are being developed, and all of you are part and parcel of that. Many of you all are benefiting. Where is the money going to come from? These are the two arguments that I frequently hear from the institute side while they are talking about this sort of a problem. Now, technically speaking, it may well be the case that the government has been, not only this present government, but the earlier regime also, has been reducing its grants to the UGC. In fact, for quite some time back, circulars have been issued by the UGC that there will be a 5% cut, sometimes yearly, sometimes across plan periods, in the budgets of institutions under the UGC, and you are supposed to search for your own funds. So UGC has this proclivity to basically occasionally issue this type of circulars, and they many a times merge with the type of sort of neoliberal within courts atmosphere which is going around all over the place. That's fine. I mean, it does happen, right? Now, if it does happen, suppose you take it as a fact that yes, there has been a reduction of grants, there is another place where there could be a reduction of grants. For example, the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment gets an allocation for this type of a scholarship that you are agitating for, and this allocation basically gets dispersed throughout the states, and previously it used to come here, now it goes for direct benefit transfer. Now, that's correct. Technically speaking, the institute has very little say over this matter, other than the fact that it could perhaps persuade those state governments which are giving the money or releasing the money very late, or who are basically creating all sorts of hurdles for students to access the scholarship. For them, one could actually have a sort of a liaison more proactively. That is something that the institute could do. But technically speaking, the institute would say that, look, it is not in our hands, it is basically in government's hands, and therefore, you either pay or you quit. Fair enough. Now, I want to locate this technicality, within a larger technicality, all right? Now, there are three things that have happened in this institute. One is that there has been a massive expansion of campus programs and people who have been appointed. So, larger number of students, larger number of faculty members, larger number of programs and campuses have all taken place. Now, it's another thing that a large number of these campuses and these programs are under legal scrutiny. There have been a lot of controversies regarding these programs, and a lot of controversies regarding, especially regarding the campuses, and everything is sort of being handled, I get the sense, in a way which is not very fair and square and above the board. So you don't really get a very clear-cut information from any quarter, even as a faculty member, as to what is basically happening as far as these campuses are concerned. Now, I'm given to understand that in solidarity with you, there have been movements like this taking place in the Hyderabad, Guwahati campuses. I'm not very sure about what's happening in Tirzapur. But many of the points that have been raised by those students are, of course, in relation to what you have said, but some of them are very specific burning problems to their campuses also. So if you were to speak to anybody connected to these campuses, it will appear as if everything is fine, which is very clearly a very big lie. It is not fine, Otherwise, people from Hyderabad and Guwahati would have just dumped you and had a jolly good time. They are also with you, so things are not fine. Now, what is the issue here, that when you basically expand this institution, and you access many different sources of funding, you play different types of rules for expanding this institution, the basic fact of the matter is that this expansion is something that is not sponsored by the UGC, alright? Now, you must understand one very specific thing, is that we come under the 2016 regulations of the deemed to be universities regulation passed by the UGC. The regulation that applied to us was 2010, and then it was 2016, right? Now, in the 2016, if you want it, I circulated it to people. All of you should carefully read it. I earnestly request you, because it will only help you to understand the scenario better. Now, there are a couple of things vis-a-vis this institution which come out very clearly from the regulations. I had written to the registrar regarding something. Obviously, as usual, he did not respond. But that apart, it's a very funny thing. I mean, you call me my colleague. I write to you once, twice, 20 times. You call me my student. I write to you 20 times and you don't respond. You know, I mean, it's a very strange human being that you are, besides being a person. Anyway, apart from that, I'll get back to him in my own way. Apart from that, when any colleague speaks, you better speak back. That's the fundamental nature of the contract. Otherwise, we don't speak. We are not colleagues. Okay. Now, as far as the problem is concerned, as far as the deemed university is concerned, give me 2 minutes. I want to point out two very crucial issues from which I will take the what I have to say forward. Number one, please understand that there are two types as far as the 2016 regulation, okay, which is applicable to all of us now. As far as the 2016 regulation, there are largely two types of deemed to be universities. One is which are government owned and controlled. So I suppose that the government pays the money to start it off, has its members in the governing board and senate, and runs the show. The other is privately owned and controlled. Okay, so which means that it has been set up by some trust or a group of people. Some of us get together and set up an NGO, then we start floating programs, and then we apply for a deemed to be university status for the programs that we run. These are the two types of universities which are deemed to be universities which are recognized by the UGC. Now, the first and foremost point about the status of a deemed to be university is that the deemed to be university means that the UGC only recognizes your degree. You apply for recognition of your degrees and your programs. That's all it does. It does not have an obligation of even one naya paisa to fund you. On the other hand, if it so desires, it can fund you for the next 100 years, giving you all the money that you require. Please understand, it is entirely up to the decision of the UGC to fund you, right? Now, this was something that was very clear to this institute for a long time. Even in 2010 regulation, this is the case. My first question to this institute is, why is it that you did not make this clear to each and every constituent body, and especially why did you not write in the prospectus, okay, that this is your status? That is, the status is, number one, that you are somebody who was established by a private body. Even now when I ask around and ask who is the owner of this institute, it's not the government, so therefore who is the owner, I never get a clear-cut answer. Okay, all that I hear is somewhere in the 1930s, you know, in the distant past, Dorab Tata Trust, I suppose, had set up this small place which became the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, which later on becomes a deemed university, right? So therefore my question is, can I therefore call the Dorab Tata Trust, now they have merged them together in the form of Tata Trust, okay? So are they our owners, right? Now the reason I'm asking this question is because the pill that all of you are given is that we are a public funded university. That is, we are owned by the government. It's a government institution. Very clearly, I think this is totally incorrect unless and until this is clarified on the public for everybody that we are actually owned and controlled by the government. Okay, that's number one. Number two is that as far as these regulations are concerned, if we are a private setup, and if you knew very clearly that the UGC has no legal obligation to give you one naya paisa, okay, then my two questions are, on the basis of what did you expand, okay, what is the burden that you incurred while expanding, and why are you invoking the name of the UGC or the central government while touching or destroying the scholarships for students, not only SCST students but also OBC and general students who do not get the NET scholarship, okay? the JRF, all right? So the question is that what is your logic on the basis of which you are blaming one sector and you are not blaming the other sector, okay? I want to just dwell on this, and I would crave your attention on this a little carefully so that you are able to get the crux of the matter, at least as far as it appears to me. Try to understand what they are telling you, okay? That is, I am telling it to you because although I know that all of you don't belong to the SCST categories or even OBC, and you might not have a problem with your funding, but because you are all standing together along with the aggrieved parties, I am addressing as you. Now, what is it that the institute is telling you by doing this? The institute is basically telling you that look, this money comes from the central government, okay? It comes via the states. We are nowhere in the picture, so we have nothing to do with your problem. So you either pay up or you go home. Number one. Clause number B under this is, look, the centi part. Look, we have been feeding you. Okay, we have been feeding you for so many years because this money has not been coming, and therefore we are taking care of you. Different words are used, feeding you, taking care of you, you are staying here for free and all that. Now, favors, giving favors and all that. Now, as far as I know from whatever, because I've also studied social work, I can also tell them a few words about social work, not only they. Now, you know, as far as I know, in the history of charity giving, most of the time one doesn't really tell that I am feeding this person or that person. That's the height of shamelessness, that you are helping somebody, you are giving somebody food and you are telling that I am giving you food. It's like giving you food and giving you a tight slap, a total humiliation. Now, this humiliation operates on the basis of a very specific logic, okay, which is this. Try to understand what the institute is telling you. The institute is telling you that we have, of course, fed you for free, but now the money isn't coming and therefore we are not going to feed you anymore. You please pay up or you go, right? Now, this very same institution which is blaming the UGC and the central government for the shortage of funds has got two, also makes two other statements simultaneously. It never says that it's a private body. It always says that it is a publicly funded university. By the way, if I'm not mistaken, in the letterhead, there's a problem there. As far as the UGC notification has come, this place cannot call itself a university. It has to write as a deemed to be university. So I will write in my own way to the registrar that why are you giving all this garbage, you know, and fooling people all the time. Anyway, that apart, now, this institute which is telling you that it cannot give you money anymore. So by you, I mean everybody, SCST, non-net, OBC, any other category, PWD, any other category, anybody who requires a little bit of help, that's all, okay? Now, this institute also has expanded marvelously. It has bought large tracts of land. Sometimes it tells us that the government gives us land. I learned that actually they also bought a part of the land and now there is some sort of a legal tangle. I don't know, because these things require a lot of detective work because they don't tell you very clearly what's happening. Anyway, this institute also has expanded enormously across campuses and programs. I was part of the working group which basically started the development studies program when many of you were not here, when 2004-2006 this whole decision to expand had taken place, okay? At that time, it was a long fought battle. We had our own reasons why development studies should come, but the main idea was that it will be only this program. Little did we know that up the sleeves of this particular person who came and abused me the other day, was no longer connected to this institute. This person basically had a whole program of marvelous and maddening expansion across the country. Now there were two types of expansion. One is an expansion of physical space, campuses. Campuses were done in such a way where there was no land. Even if there was land, there was no money to build buildings. And the second expansion that took place, besides the programs that were sort of started almost overnight, one after the other, was also the hiring of staff and teachers, right? Now, as you know, if you care to look at accounts carefully, the biggest burden on any university or any governmental organization always is the salary burden. So we get paid very well. Even when in the fourth pay commission, when we were begging and borrowing money as faculty members because our pay was very low compared to the inflation, even then compared to what was happening outside, we used to get paid very well. So therefore, our salary is the biggest burden on this institution, right? Now, this is the case with all government or all institutions. Now, when this sort of a thing is taking place, the institute is expanding at a maddening pace. It is able to generate a lot of money from the private sector. It is able to appoint a huge number of temporary faculty, people on contract, and also it is able to employ a large number of on-contractual staff, fourth class employees and staff, okay? When it is able to do that, it very clearly means that there is a dichotomy, an unspoken but a very clearly thought out devious dichotomy that is operating within this institution in the same body. Number one, when it is possible or for whatever reasons, we will feed you, but we will not feed you when we are able to cite that the government is not giving us money. On the other hand, we will go to enormous extents to feed other people. That is, we will hire and appoint a large number of people, many of them staff, many of them faculty members. We will bring in students in huge numbers, increase the fees tremendously, put them 3, 3, 4, 4, 6 students in a small room called a hostel room, feed them food which destroys their stomachs, charge them very heavily. We will do all that, okay? But at the same time, tell the scholarship holders that, sorry, this government is to blame, we can't help you. So now I'm posing a question for you. Who does this institute own as its own? Who belongs to this institute? Do these scholarship holders belong to this institute? My feeling is, my understanding is no. Because you all have been told that your headache lies with the government. We will not be able to do anything for you. We are washing our hands of you. Okay? On the other hand, it goes to enormous pains to send people abroad, to basically appoint people at different scales, to give them a lot of projects, to do many other things which have never been mandated by the UGC. Most of the time, there is almost next to no funding from the UGC for all these activities. At that time, they are very clear that it is this constituency which they own. In other words, what is very clear is that essentially the private sector, the non-UGC part, is what the institute owns. The UGC part it only uses in order to further facilitate this private part, and if necessary, the students who are part of the UGC can be sacrificed when the time comes. So I'm once again asking you, do you, all of you who are standing for the institute, do you belong to this institute? No, you all don't belong to this institute. It is those people who have received the benefits and privileges, okay, from this institute, largely drawn from the private funding, non-UGC funding, generated by this institute, who actually the institute is bothered about. It is they who form the headache. Scheduled caste and scheduled tribes are the scum of this institute. They are not bothered about these people at all. And all of you who stand along shoulder to shoulder with scheduled caste and scheduled tribe and OBC students, now we are being lumped together as basically being the scum of this institute. Why is that so? Precisely because it feels that there is, you do not constitute a constituency of this place, okay? The constituency actually belongs to those people whom this institute wants to favor, and you all are simply out of favor. this dichotomy you must understand very clearly, which lies at the heart of the institute. So it's very easy therefore for the administration to tell you to get out. It's very easy for this administration, no matter how many times you speak to them, to say that we are not budging, citing some figures. Of course these figures are correct, they are probably most of the time very correct, but I am trying to put you the location, the framework within these figures.